songs, some of the songs that we just sang.
Thank you, Stan. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Those are some tough lyrics, aren't they, when we really think about what we just asked God to do with us. Write on my heart every word. What happens when Jesus says or does or comes at us in a way we don't expect? What then will we do? We're going to talk some about that today as we look at Luke chapter 7, and I encourage you to turn there with me in Luke chapter 7. I was having some difficulties with the copier, and so the outlines will be available later. Luke chapter 7, verses 24 through 35. This lesson is about John. This lesson is about Jesus and how John the Baptist and Jesus came at people in a way that they weren't expecting. And because it wasn't the approach or what they had in their minds or their assumptions that they had planned, the story that they had told in their mind, they shut down and they wouldn't listen to Jesus and they wouldn't listen to John. And what we have here in Luke chapter 7, good morning, by the way. What we have in Luke chapter 7 is Jesus having been sent two messengers by John the Baptist. John is in prison. He's about to die. John is asking for assurance and affirmation. Are you really the one? Are you really the one? And everybody made different reasons he's asking that, but he's asking Jesus for that assurance. And so Jesus does all these miracles. He does all these miracles and he says, okay, I want you two messengers to go back and say, look, the blind see, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Blessed is he who is not offended by me. And so he sends those messengers back, and then he turns to the crowd and he starts talking about John the Baptist. And understand, as we have just invited Jesus to tell us hard things, what Jesus says here is hard. As he talks to the people. When John's messengers had gone, verse 24, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. What did you go out to the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? What did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who are dressed in splendid clothing and live in luxury are in king's courts. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way before you. John the Baptist was prophesied both by Isaiah and Malachi. I tell you, among those born of women. Can you imagine this set of you? Listen to what Jesus said about John the Baptist. I tell you, among those born of women, none is greater than John. Yet one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And when all the people heard this, and the tax collectors too, they declared God just, having been baptized with the baptism of John. But what did the Pharisees and lawyers do? The Pharisees and the lawyers rejected the purpose of God for themselves, not having been baptized by him. We're going to come to that section, verse 29 and 30, at the end of the lesson. Verse 31, Jesus asks great questions, doesn't he? To what then shall I compare the people of this generation, and what are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another, we played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not weep. For John the Baptist has come eating no bread and drinking no wine, and you say he has a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is justified by all her children. God's truth will bear out in the end. And so Jesus asks this question, and that's the title of the lesson this morning. What did you go out to see? Love you all so much, and I'm glad you're here. If you're a visitor, glad you're with us. If anyone has any questions, feel free to see me afterwards. Jesus and John the Baptist, number one. From what we see here, we're not what many people expected, right? They're just not what many expected. He says, what did you go out to see? Let's go back up in verse 24. When John's messengers had gone, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. What did you go out to see? A what? A reed shaken by the wind? I want you to picture that image in your mind, because that can be true of you and me. This idea of just going back and forth in the wind. What the culture says, what consensus says, what polls say. We kind of put our finger up in the air and listen for the wind. You feel the wind. Which way is it going? That's the way we're going to believe. Is that what you expected out of John, he says? I don't think Jesus is wasting words. I think that is what they expected of John. And that's not what they got out of John, is it? Is that the kind of person that John was, of trying to get consensus before he stood on the truth? His main message was consistent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for Messiah is coming. Repent, as was said so well by Alan, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That was John the Baptist who said that in John 1. He said, repent, because Messiah is coming. And his message was indiscriminate. He had different specifics for different people, but the message of repentance was the same for everybody, wasn't it? The people who came to him, they said, what shall we do? In Luke chapter 3, he says, well, if you have a lot of money, make sure that you give of your things to help others. That's a sign of repentance, isn't it? That may be hard to hear, but that's what he said. Okay, what about the tax collectors and the soldiers that came to Jesus? And he says, well, don't be threatening people and be content with your wages and don't cheat people and be good to people. We're talking about our relationships and how we live out in the world. Well, sometimes we don't do that as Christians, and they weren't doing it back then, and John had to tell them to repent. This is what you have to do. Well, how about his message to King Herod? King Herod was married to his brother Philip's wife. It's interesting how the Holy Spirit said that. He was married to one, bound to another. Married to one, bound to another. That's another sermon coming down the road, Lord willing. But he was married to one, bound to the other. And the Holy Spirit says he had rebuked him because he's a brother Philip's wife. And repentance for Herod is give that relationship up. You know what happened to John because of that? We may not be beheaded today, but I can tell you that's an emotional thing to talk about. And it can stir up great emotions. But at the end of the day, we have to look at the Word of God and say, what does it say? What does it say? And I know many of you looking at me today have lived that, and I appreciate your heart. What does the Bible say? And so, understand, his message cost him his life, his message of repentance. He stood firm. I mean, the Pharisees came out to him, and, you know, again, they're out there in their fancy clothes, which I'll come to in a moment. They're out there in their fancy clothes, and they're all about appearances, and they got their noses up in the air. And the moment he walks up to him and said, you bunch of snakes. How's that going to work in a 2024 world? It didn't work well then. And I'm not saying that we intentionally go out and try to hurt people. That we're not speaking the truth in love, and then I'm going to talk more about that later in the lesson too. But next, let's keep going. What did you go out to see? A man dressed in what kind of clothing? Soft clothing, right? He says, those who dress in splendid clothing and live in luxury are in king's courts. Now, I know from preaching long enough that I might distract somebody, so I want to say this. I'm not saying that what we wear here doesn't matter, and what we wear when we're up here doesn't matter. That's a different lesson for another day. That's coming too. We give God our best. And that's relative, but we give God our best. That's another principle. I want to talk about that, but please set that aside in your mind. What I'm saying is, what Jesus said is, what did you expect? A man in splendid clothing? I want you to look for a moment with me in Luke chapter 20. How did the Pharisees dress? And I think that maybe this explains what people were expecting when they were expecting some great prophet of God, because the religious leaders of their day were pretentious snobs. And that's the way they went around the temple, and that's the way they dressed. In Luke chapter 20, in verse 45 through 47, Luke 20, 45 through 47. And in the hearing of all the people, that's a phrase that's neat in the book of Luke. And in the hearing of all the people, he said to his disciples, beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and love greetings in the marketplaces and the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. Maybe that's what these people are expecting. Well, maybe John the Baptist is going to look like these teachers and these leaders. And how? What's he wearing? What's Matthew chapter 3 verse 4 tell us? The Bible tells us that he was wearing camel's hair and a leather belt. And his diet always gets me, locusts and wild honey, you know. I'm not sure how many calories that is on your chart. I want you to picture the scene on the judgment day. Now again, we don't know all about what the judgment day is. Just bear with me in a little poetry, symbolism. Imagine the scene at the judgment day where these people have fallen before Jesus Christ on their knees, because every knee will bow. And they're before Jesus. And Jesus says, why didn't you listen to John? And they say, I couldn't get past the camel hair. Okay, come on in. Really? What if John the Baptist, and again, put that other issue aside that I talked about. What if he stood up here in his camel hair and he preached to us a message that punches us in the mouth and steps on our toes and hits us right in our souls with the word of God? Will we get distracted by the camel hair? I know, I heard someone say that. Good job. I want to make this more than clothing. That's not what this is about. Like I said, the issue here is not about clothing. The issue is about my expectations. John came to them in a way they didn't expect, and so they shut down. Does that not happen in our relationships? Think about it. It does happen. It happens where we make something about the camel's hair instead of the truth that is being said. Well, you didn't say it right. Really? Was it? And I'm going to talk about that too. But if somebody didn't say it to me right, maybe, you know, again, maybe it's in a marriage. Your spouse, maybe they say something that singes your hair. And, okay, they're going to be accountable to God for how they said it. But I'm going to say this again later. But once you calm down, think about what was said. Was it true? Did you need to hear it? And so sometimes, well, it's not, doesn't come out the way I think it should be. Well, it's still truth. I'm going to talk about, again, more about that as we go. And so we understand their expectations. This is how I think. Boy, and I'm telling you, we can be guilty of that ourselves. Myself, I can do it, you can do it. This is how I think it should roll in the Bible. This is how I think it should be. This is how I think Jesus should come at me. And he just turns it all upside down on his head and says, I want you to rethink that. Change your expectations and listen to the word of God. And so John the Baptist and Jesus were not what many expected. Was Jesus what his disciples expected? No. Jesus was not what many were expecting. Even his 12 apostles struggled with this. Jesus was rebuked by Peter because he said he was going to die. It's not how he expected it. And what I have to do is put my expectations and my own narrative and my own story aside. Second point. Jesus and John, let's look down in verse 33. They were two different men, and they had two very different approaches. Those of you who know the Old Testament, you know that John is like Elijah. Well, it seems like Jesus is kind of like Elisha. John's out in the wilderness. Elijah was out in the wilderness. Elisha's out in all the homes and houses and cities, and that's kind of what Jesus did. Okay? And so they're two different men with two very different approaches. Jesus is always at dinner, at a wedding. I'd like that part. He's at a dinner, a wedding, a feast, or in people's homes, especially when you read Luke. He's always going to dinner or inviting himself into someone's house. John's out in the wilderness. He eats locusts and wild honey. He made a Nazarite vow, which is in Numbers chapter 6. He didn't eat grapes. He didn't raisins. He didn't drink wine. He didn't have any of that. Okay? It was a very extreme vow. He didn't come eating and drinking. Jesus came eating and drinking. Paul and Barnabas, did they have different approaches? You can think about and write down in your notes Acts 15. Paul and Barnabas had a very different approach about how to handle John Mark, and it came so bad that they split ways. Different approaches, just like the four gospel accounts. God gave us four gospel accounts. They're all written by the Holy Spirit, but they're all written by different men with different styles and different reasons for writing. And we need to understand that. I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We are in a body with hands and arms and feet and eyes and legs. We're all different. Some are introverts. Some are extroverts. I put the capital E in extrovert. Okay? Some are introverts. You know, some people talk to think and some people think to talk. And both of us have things we got to work on. Some people are real detail oriented. They make great accountants. That wouldn't be a good job for me. I like big ideas, sometimes forget the details. But you know, we need all different kinds of people. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I'd love to read the whole text, but just for sake of time, I just want to read verse 18. You can read the whole text on your own at home. Verse 18, but as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each one of them as he chose. As he chose. God chose Ezekiel, who was a priest. God chose David, who was a shepherd. God chose Moses, who was raised up in Pharaoh's palace. Okay, God chose Amos, who was a farmer. He chose Peter, who was a fisherman. He chose Paul, who was a religious legal scholar. And you can tell by their writings, they had different approaches. In our Bible class this morning in the back, we were talking about how Peter said, yeah, Paul writes some things that are just hard to understand. I love that phrase in 2 Peter 3. They had different approaches. Both are used by God. Do we have elders and preachers and deacons and teachers with different personalities and gifts and approaches? Aren't they all needed? Parents have made different approaches to raising their kids. And you talk about something sometimes that has caused strife in churches is different people's approaches to how we educate our children. And that's going to lead to a third point. As we think about in this, before we move there, but just that John and Jesus were different men with different approaches. They came with different approaches, but both were used by God. Third thing. I want you to go back with me to Luke 7. John and Jesus had different approaches. Was one better than the other? They're both sent by God. David, Solomon, they had different approaches. David's purpose in his life was to go destroy the enemies around him and get the temple ready. Solomon's purpose was to build the temple. They had different purposes. Solomon was a man of peace. David was a man of war. They had different approaches. Both were used by God. We have to understand this. You know, but then we get into sometimes when fights go and whether it's in a marriage or in a family or in the church or politically, we just start throwing labels. Have you ever had a label thrown at you? Someone just put you in a box, closed up the lid, taped it up, and said, this is how you are. Do you like that? No, I don't like that. I've had it done to me, but you know I've done it to other people too. And I say that because, you know, Dallin, we're doing real well. I'm not saying we're doing bad about this, but we know what's happening this year is a very highly charged season. The world is going to act like the world. That must not be true of God's people. It must not be true of us. And when we're talking with people religiously, we don't just slap a label on them. One person takes a stand and you call them a legalist. And the other person takes a stand and you say, well, you don't care about Bible authority. Like, how can you move forward to discuss something when we've slapped the worst kinds of labels? You don't have love. You don't have faith. How can you move forward and have a discussion with somebody when you've assumed the worst about their character? Does this happen in marriage? Well, you don't submit to me. Well, you don't love me. Well, great. Where are we going for our second point? Okay? So if we think about these ideas, is that sometimes those labels just get slapped on something, and it shuts down conversation. And sometimes it is used as a way for me to deflect and distract from the real issue at hand. Doesn't that happen in our relationships? Doesn't that happen sometimes when maybe I'm hearing something that's some hard teaching and I don't want to hear it, so I'm going to get my baseball bat out and I'm going to hit it. I'm going to deflect it. That's what these people did. Luke chapter 7. John the Baptist, verse 33. John the Baptist has come eating no bread and drinking no wine, and you say he has a demon. How much worse can you get than that? They didn't say, well, you know, he's kind of crazy, but no. He's a little weird, but I mean, I don't like the locust thing, but no. He's got a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and what do they accuse him of? He was a glutton and a drunkard. Brothers and sisters, what must be true of all of us in our relationships and as a church and as we live out into this world, especially knowing how crazy this world is getting, we must not be the people that do that. We must set the example and the standard and the pattern for others where we don't behave like these people did, because John couldn't say anything to him because their mind was already set that he had a demon. Jesus couldn't say anything to him because their minds were already set. He was a sinner, a glutton, a drunkard. He hung out with the wrong people. And so it didn't matter what he said, it just hit the wall. And that happens in our relationships. And we have to be careful about that. And so the fourth point. Did it really matter what approach Jesus and John used? I don't mean that it doesn't mean that I can go scream at people. That's not what I mean. I'm talking about one came one way, one came the other. Did it really in the end, did they listen? They didn't listen. Neither approach, they listened. And notice what he says in verse 31. To what then shall I compare the people of this generation, and what are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace calling to one another. They're playing games. Hey, we're playing wedding. We're playing funeral. And you're not coming in. You're not playing our game. It's just kids playing games. And he's describing them as kids playing games and being selfish because you didn't follow my rules. You ever get a bunch of kids together and watch them play and how they keep changing the rules? Oh, you know, when you start shooting each other and bam, 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 and someone says, I'm everything proof. Well, that just shuts it all down. Get that kid out of there. Go take them. They're going to be a politician or something. It doesn't matter what approach they used. They weren't going to listen. And I don't want that. These are challenging things. And I don't want, as a Christian, and I know you don't want as a Christian, for us to shut down because whatever approach is being used, I get all caught up in that instead of listening to the truth. Galatians chapter 4, verse 16. Sometimes these kind of deflections and such are manipulative tactics. It's just tactics to just try to distract from the real thing at hand. And don't bite. I don't know how many bitefuls I've taken of those over the years where someone has done that to me and I just keep falling for it. No, you don't have to bite. You're still teaching the truth. But Galatians 4 verse 16, what did Paul say? He says, have I become your enemy because I told you the truth? Paul told them what they needed to hear. And instead of listening to it, instead of repenting, they made Paul the enemy. That must not be true of us. Ezekiel chapter 33. Turn with me to Ezekiel 33. Verses 30 through 33. Ezekiel 33, verses 30 through 33. Now, I'm going to transition in a moment that approach does matter because That's a big part of the Bible too, and we're going to show the Bible on that as well. But here's the thing, and I'm going to keep saying this: whether someone says it sweetly or hard, I have to at some time say, okay, was it true? And here's someone who spoke very nicely, and they love to hear him preach, and he said it in a way that just sounded like a musical instrument playing. Just beautiful. Someone just playing on a piano or a violin. Ezekiel 33, verse 30. As for you, son of man, your people who talk together about you by the walls and at the doors of the houses say to one another, each to his brother, come and hear what the word is that comes from the Lord. Well, that sounds hopeful. They're going to hear the word of the Lord. Well, that sounds good. Just keep reading. Verse 31, and they come to you as people come, and they sit before you as my people, and they hear you say, but they what? They will not do it. For with lustful talk in their mouths they act, for their heart is set on gain. And behold, you are to them like one who sings lustful songs with a beautiful voice and plays well on an instrument. For they hear what you say, but they will not do it. And when this comes, and it come it will, then they will know that a prophet has been among them. Whether someone says it eloquently or choppy. You know, it's funny, I've noticed over the years, I've had a lot of different Bible studies. I remember one time I thought I just did the most amazing presentation in a Bible study, and a person didn't listen to it and they walked away. And another time I just chopped it all up and butchered it, and like, why did I even get out of bed this morning? And that person's heading to the baptistry. Huh. Now again, I'm not saying how I teach or how you teach is unimportant. But sometimes it doesn't matter how well it's presented, someone won't listen. Matthew 23. I want to move on to another topic when we come to under this idea as we're starting to wrap this lesson up. This is something that I believe is a huge sign of maturity and humility and discernment. Because what if somebody comes to you like Pharisees did? The Pharisees in Matthew chapter 23, you want to see Jesus give a blistering attack on a group of people? Read Matthew 23. It was blistering. It was excoriating. He just got them left and right for their hypocrisy and their self-righteousness and standing in the doorway of the kingdom of heaven. And they were laying heavy burdens on other people, but they wouldn't lift it with their own fingers. And Jesus has a lot of things to say about them, but I want you to notice he begins this by talking to the people first. Verse 1, Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, the scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. They're teaching the law. They're teaching the word of God. So do and observe whatever they tell you, but listen to this. But don't do the works that they do, for they preach and they don't practice. I'm really passionate about this point because I have watched a number of Christians walk away and have deconstructed, as the new term is, or deconverted because of how Christians have behaved. And this is hard, and it's real. Sometimes how Christians have behaved have turned people to say, I don't want anything to do with it. And what we have to do is we have to have some discernment. Because Jesus, as he talks to the people about the Pharisees, he says, you know, they're teaching you a lot of truth. Listen to it. Don't follow their behavior. And I want you to keep also this verse in mind. Later in Matthew 23 and verse 32, what is the end of the Pharisee if they don't repent? Matthew 23. Well, I put the wrong verse down. He says, how can you escape the condemnation of hell? And I can't find the verse here. I'm standing here and wrote down the wrong verse. It is verse 33. You serpents, you brood of vipers. Again, he calls them a bunch of snakes, just like John the Baptist did. How are you to escape being sentenced to hell? I want you to meditate on this. Were they teaching a lot of truth? Are you with me? Where are they going? Are they teaching truth? Where are they going? If that doesn't pierce you to your soul, then you don't have a conscience. I can preach the truth all the way to hell. All the way to hell. Does your approach matter? Because sometimes when I'll talk about, you know, the things that I just said earlier, there are people, and I've seen Christians like this over the years, well, they'll hear those things and say, see, it doesn't matter. They're just too sensitive, and they just need to listen to me. Nuh-uh. I'm talking to two different things here. One is, this is a sign for me of, and a sign for you of humility and discernment and maturity to be able to, after someone says something in a horrible way, and they were self-righteous and condemning, you have to understand, okay, I've calmed down about that. They're going to be judged by God for showing no mercy, but I have to sort out, is there something in there that I needed to hear? That's hard. And you tell me, I'm not just talking about preachers and teachers, I'm talking about marriage. I'm talking about parenting. I'm talking about at work. Maybe your boss lays you flat and they were a jerk. Okay, but maybe I need to step back, lick my wounds a little bit, because words do hurt. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. It hurts. But maybe I need to say, okay, after I hit my punching bag for a while, go out and run a few miles or whatever you do, scream in the woods, and then pray. Maybe not in that order. And then say, was it right? And that's maturity. I tell you, we are in an age where everybody's feelings are on their sleeves. And we have to think, am I just being sensitive? Or am I being told by the elders, by a preacher, by my parents, by my brother or sister in Christ, something that I need to hear, and I just keep pushing it away for one reason or another? If we do that, we're no different than the people of Jesus' day. We're no different than the people that listened to John. And I also say that to my good friends, but I'm saddened by it. I ache by it because I know how they were treated, and I know it was wrong, but you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. That's what my mom said. You don't throw out Bible and authority and Jesus because someone mistreats you. And that's what's happening today. And that saddens me. And I don't want that to be true here, Dallin. Collectively or individually. And we have to come down to the question, what does the Bible say? Take the labels and throw them in the trash can. Take our sensitivities and throw them in the trash can and sit down and say, what does the Bible say? Take my expectations and my assumptions and throw them in the trash can. What does the Bible say? Take my narrative, my story, throw it in the trash can and say, what does the Bible say? And then we all will get somewhere. Luke chapter 7. When all the people heard this, we just read this, and the tax collectors too, they declared God just, having been baptized with the baptism of John, but the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the purpose of God for themselves. Some versions say the will of God for themselves. Why? Because they hadn't been baptized by John. Now, we're not preaching John's baptism. That's done away in the cross. But we are preaching baptism because that's what Jesus taught us to preach. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. Now I want to ask you a question. Are you more like the Jewish leadership or more like the tax collectors who listened to what God said and said, it doesn't matter, I'm going to follow God? Are you willing to be baptized into Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins? To accept Jesus as he says on his terms, not on my terms? But I don't say it just to those who aren't Christians. I say that to every one of us. Are we willing to follow Jesus on his terms? Is that true of you and me? Think about these things as we stand and sing.